Gullah Geechee identifies a culture, a language, and also a group of people. Those people who are descendants primarily of enslaved West Africans who were brought during the plantation era to work the cash crops of cotton, indigo, and rice.
When somebody talk about Gullah or Geechee, is really the language that we speak, and we speak the language from our ancestors from Africa.
Well, Geechee means a lot of people got it with an accent, and a lot of people always tell me that I have a Gullah accent. I worked with the Forest Service for 29 years, and there was a guy named Danny Carlson, and he lived in New York City. Now you can tell if he is he is not a Yankee anymore. He have a Southern accent. So I always figure, Gullah mean if you hang around someone long enough, then you begin to speak Gullah.
When I first left Georgetown, and I went to live. It's in Boston, because my husband is from Boston. And I told everybody that I was a saltwater Geechee gal. Now, saltwater Geechee gal. And then there were always comments says, oh, I said something, call somebody Geechee. And those were fighting words. They were to a lot of people.
Growing up, it was a term that they pretty much used for some of us Southern people and the dialect in which we spoke. And as I grew up and now look back and they talk about the Gullah language and whatnot, I think back to my grandparents and great-grandparents and their words echo in my brain and, okay, they were speaking Gullah.
A lot of my family members, elders, a lot of them, they speak it, you know, just naturally. You know, when I was growing up, I had a hard time trying to, interpret. Mm-hmm. And hearing it enough, you know, I understand what they mean. Like, you would say, Hunter, meaning they, y'all.
Complicated. Sad sometimes, comforting sometimes, extremely, I use the word educational, but it's deeper than that somehow. I just can't find the words. A place to be taught, colorful, and very vivid colors. Rhythmic, you know, and very connected with the water.
Being from the low country, Georgetown, you see the rice fields, you see the marsh, the pluff mud, all of those things was interesting and intriguing to me. And just to imagine people being amongst that every single day and having a task to do. For me growing up, that was something that I wanted to discover. And I just found ways, I found that my way of understanding it and exploring that was through painting and drawing.
All right, so my wife, she's born on a plantation, on Acadia Plantation.
Okay.
So it has something to do with food, you know, it has something to do with talk. You know, it has something to do with, I guess it's like a psychological thing.
We cooked on wood stove, we have outhouses, and we did all the farming and harvesting our food. We go and get, like, we had to go and cut wood and bring it back, the heat and to cook on. My grandmama and her friends would have come over and sit down under the tree, and they sew a basket all day, and they go from house to house. If somebody come today, they say, well, I going to so-and-so house tomorrow, then we'll stay. Then we'll stay at the house. We cannot leave the yard or go anywhere to play, and then until they come back. But the trick we didn't used to get us is that when we start sewing basket, they give everybody a certain size, a basket to sew, but didn't know exactly when, how much time that they gonna have, so when they can come back from work, we still be there.
My grandma, on my mother's side, her father had a farm, hated it, but every summer we were on the fields. Yeah. We were in the fields. We were doing cropping tobacco. In the fall and the winters, we were picking sweet potatoes. My grandma had a garden, so, you know, we were doing cabbage. And, I mean, anything that was grown in the ground that you could eat, you know, with her grandsons and grandkids, we were all there. So every summer, I spent my time with my grandma, and we were in the farm, at the farm, on the fields. And so there was a lot of memories there with spending time with my family and my cousins, laughing, joking around.
I worked for a man named York McGinnis, which was a black guy, and he had a cotton field, watermelon field, okra, tomato. I would rather had worked for the white man, because he was a slave driver.
Okay.
And he only gave you like, was a penny, a penny a 100 pound of cotton. Now, it doesn't match my age, because you remember now, in the 50, we were still picking cotton, corn, and in McLennanville, everything was still as it was until, you know, till the Democrat get in there, or Republican got in there and start getting things from overseas or
right.
Further out, and then that did away with all that in McLennanville.
Okay.
But my childhood, we used to love that, going picking oyster, flounder gigging, thing we call mullet. We used to get a mullet net, and we used to cast for mullet in the wintertime because they bunched together. And me and my friend got a wheelbarrow, and we used to go through the neighborhood and sell 25 fish for a quarter. Well, we were rich.
And we lived at the very end of Butt Street. Sometimes we call it the cul-de-sac, and we call it a big ditch. But little did we know that it was not, now I know why it was a big ditch, because it was a canal bringing the water in from the Sampat River. So we played in the big ditch, and they had ditches, and all day long we would try to catch the minnows, and then we would catch crawfish, and a lot of times we'd get punished, because you want to catch a red devil. It looks almost like a lobster, a small lobster. So you'd go in and sneak some of the fat meat that your mother had, and somehow you get caught doing that or whatever. But, you know, because children, you know, you don't cut slice thing. You're going to cut off a little inky-dinky part, you know, that the meat has been bothered with. And then you put it on a string, put it down a hole, and then they, you know, try to get it, and you pull it up, you know. Then I was also a little snake hunter. And at that time, yeah, we had a lot of hognose snakes. If you know the thing about hognose snake, if they feel a vibration or what, they just turn over like they dead, you know.
Okay.
But my mother never knew we were playing with hognose snake. She would have killed us. Now, I want to tell you a little thing that she kept the lizards out of the house. She says, if you fool around with lizards, and said, lizards love to you know what, and if they would pee on you, it would turn a little girl into a little boy, and turn a little boy into a little girl. So we never fool around with the lizard. Only thing that we says, lizard, lizard, show me a blanket. And they were always sticking their tongue out for me.
Sitting around telling stories, food, the way they cook, Just the simple way we dress. You basically accept just about anybody, you know, just that unconditional love, you know. Okay. That's what I grew up under in that culture, what I've known.
My mother passed away at an early age. I was 7 when she passed, and she was only 27. So when my father had to travel or to had to go to work or something, we would always go and stay with Grandmom and Granddad. And Grandmom would always be there for us, taking care of us, even after we had grown up. All the other grandchildren called her Grandmom, but with me and my sibling, we just called her Mama. She was a faithful woman also, and very strong in who she was, and would do anything that she could to help us or to help anyone that she came in contact with.
I think that some of my best memories are around Christmas. It was a big deal to barbecue that hog. So to have all the old dudes around, and we could never go outside. I mean, as young women, you couldn't go outside because they had beer or whatever they were drinking or whatever. But just to be able to, you know, sit, we used to like gather around the door, screen door, just inside and listen to as much of the conversation as we were allowed to listen to before we were, you know, snap back into reality, and to really just be able to see your grandparents as real people talking about real stuff. My grandmother used to, you know, she was very church oriented and all that, but me, during the Christmas holiday, she used to cook and listen to Red Fox. Man, come on, Red Fox.
My mother would always state, time and tide wait for no man. All my siblings recall her giving that proverb to us. And it was very important because we lived on an island, and we did not have an automobile. So there was usually people coming to pick us up. You needed to make sure that you left in time so that if the bridge was closed, because the draw went up, that you would still make it on time or more before time. I am a product of the Penn School. Both of my parents are graduates of Penn School, the class of 1933. So I grew up attending the Community Sings at Penn Center. And because I was a member of the Brick Baptist Church, which is located just across the highway from the Penn Center, singing spirituals were an important part of my childhood. And that is an important aspect of Gullah Geechee culture and heritage. The rhythms of the songs are and the types of songs, call and response, are all because of our West African heritage.
Once I got here, this is something pertaining to Gullah, they would wave at me. And my mentality from the city, I'm like, man, you know, yeah, I don't know you. What is, you know, what you waving at me for? And my mentality was, okay, coming from the city and not caring about people laying on the ground, hurt or something, you walk over them, man. You really don't speak, things like that. So I got here and they would wave, and I would tell my wife, I said, okay, man, they want to wave at me. They must be trying to set me up. It must be something slick, okay, because this is the environment that I have come from. Okay, I said, well, it must be something slick. When they come, I'll be waiting, you know. And she's like, man, you're so paranoid. They're just hailing you.
For me, it was family. Always trying to keep connected to family. My father, after my mother passed, he had 5 children that he was rearing. And he always made sure that we knew who our relatives were. He would take us, you know, to visit relatives, no matter where they were, almost from New York and Washington, D.C., and some locally here.
And I remember when my grandmother and Miss Torter and all of them went so they could learn how to read. They were first generation, learn how to read and write. But they were so strong. All the ladies in the community seemed as though they were doing something, because this is an African thing, working side by side, helping the family. Like Mrs. Georgie on my street, she would starch, stretch curtains and make those dollies, you know, that they put on the back of the chair and standing up. A few of them did housework, and my mother was a midwife, had a couple of midwives, and then, you know, we have the stevedore, and Mrs. Mohn would cook and sell food. And then Mrs. Jenny Shedrick, there were a lot of people who had stores and other businesses. I know one of my neighbor next door that lived to now, she used to press iron clothes for the Kaminsky. She didn't go, they would bring it there, and some black guy would pick it up and bring it, and then she would do these clothes, and she had about 10 children too. But all of these ladies, they were always doing something, you know. And then all of them, you know, some of them even sold liquor, or they had gambling parties. But all of these people, and then there were four of them on my street that taught school, you know. So you had, and then it used to be the cab stand right on the corner, right there, in which blacks still control the taxi business in Georgetown today, and that's where the cab stand was. And Mr. Robertson, he had the cab stand, plus he did, he was one of them, and then he had other real estate. But everybody was doing things. Because my dad worked at the International Paper Company as a laborer, and then in the afternoon, he would work at, because when he was a young man, he worked at the Atlantic Coastline, and he would take us there, and we would help him dust the offices and stuff in the afternoon. And the guy that he worked for, he would never give us any money. And Daddy, and I said, you know, I'm tired of Mr. Gagin. He's always giving us these books. We had our volume library, and we had the first edition. I realized it was the first edition of Peter Pan and stuff like that. But okay. And then my dad had all these chickens and ducks, and he would sell eggs. Everybody did something.
My mother's grandfather basically was my father when I didn't have one. And basically he mentored me into things of God. He used to have a saying that I never understood back then, but I understood now. And it's, you know, people would say character would take you far than money would. He would say manners would take you farther than money would. And that's what he taught us, you know, to be respectful to each other, respectful to our elders, love, you know, very family oriented. And had I not, you know, like saying, have I not gotten that from him, you know, I wouldn't be the man that I am. As he took care of me, I took care of him during the latter part of his dying days.
I remember my grandmother. We would go to Huntington Beach all the time, and we would collect periwinkles, the little shells, and she would make periwinkle soup, and all it was potato soup, but the periwinkles had all these beautiful colors in them, so that's all they would do. The shells would just color the soup and just give you that little seafood taste. And she would always remind us, you never covet what other people have. Don't ever covet what other people have, because you know that whatever it is, you can make it enough, and you can make it good, and it'll be enough. And she would always tell us that when she served us that periwinkle soup. And so we thought it was like a delicacy, you know, we thought it was like something fancy. And after a while, she just, you know, it's just potato soup. Just potato soup in a clear block. That's all it is. But you have the ability to make anything something.
My father. I mean, the kids now say that that's my hero. Or, you know, I just love. I've never left my father. Wherever he go, I went.
Okay.
Crabbing, fishing, everything, everything. Believe it or not, at the age of 15, I built my first house. Whole house. Me and two guys, me and one more guy. And this lady was living in a shack. And we tore the shack down, take the board off it, and build the house back up. And my father, you know, was telling, you know, he'll go up there on Saturday and look at it and say, we gotta tear that board down, boy, that ain't right. That ain't right, you gotta put that over here. And so, you know, he was guiding us a little bit.
I had a big family, so on my mom's side, she has 10 siblings. And then on my dad's side, he has 4. So it was any holiday, it was getting together, eating, even on Sundays. So a tradition for me would be getting up early Sunday morning, going to Sunday school, staying there all day until through church till 1, going to my grandma's house, eating Sunday dinner, and staying there until 6. My brother and I, we would watch WCW with at my grandma's house, and my parents would be there, and then some, we would, you know, flip channels back and forth while my grandma's like, turn back, we're like, oh, grandma, we want to see WCW. But there were certain shows that my grandma wanted to see on Sundays, and so that was every Sunday, and we would go home early enough just to, you know, wash up and go to bed. So that was a staple for me, and also it was the beginning of me understanding Christianity and spirituality.
She was my mother's first cousin, I believe, and they were about the same age. She was slightly younger than my mother, but she went to every funeral. And she may not have known, okay, but everyone knew that if there was a funeral, she was going to be there.
I have a school
friend
like that.
Yeah. She, and her children, when young, would always be accompanying her to the funerals, but that's just what she did.
They learned us how to cook, how to wash. We used to wash clothes on the washboard. We used to get the hot water and boil it in a separate tub, and used to put the white clothes in there, take it out and hang it out, and that clothes look like white as snow. You do a lot of, get your chores done, and on Fridays, we do all of that for one bag of peanut. And you'd be so happy for that bag of peanut, because that's a treat that they're looking for. On Friday, when my granddaddy come from the grocery store, he have a bag of peanut for everybody who does their work. But thing about it, he have the one for one who ain't done the work. He let them suffer for a little while, and then he say, "Hey, next time, you do your work, and then you will get your peanut."
Say, well, that's from the Geechee, you know, the Geechee building, because everybody from the South lived in that particular building. And they had a particular way of doing things. Am I going off? Okay, they had a particular way. We knew if we went to a party, you know, like, hey man, the Geechee's is having a party, man. We were gonna get food, man. They were gonna have fried chicken, greens, like a ham, you know, soda, a cake. Yeah.
It goes back to my grandmother, my dad's mother, and my mom. You know, and like every winter or fall, you know, we had like pecan trees, pear. They would can the pears, you know, bottle them up, and gather the pecans and roast them. And sometimes they would make pies, you know, cakes. You know, I mean, those things kind of like stick in my memory. And my grandfather, being that he grew his own food, my grandmother used to can and bottle those up and save them, you know, for a hard time. And then also the kids, you know, her, you know, my aunties and all of them, they went off. They want that stuff. She would ship them off, you know, to them, and so they can have a piece of the South, of home.
Remember, with eight siblings that my father had, we didn't have no ham, okay. Store-bought ham. Okay. We didn't ever eat a duck out of the store or anything like this. Everything we ate was homegrown. And my father said the same thing. If I knew how to make salt and all them other things, sugar, he wouldn't have to buy anything. We had pear for the, you know, in the summertime, you get the pear, my mother canned it. The bean, canned it. Okra, canned it. Peach, canned it. Pear, apple, canned it. Corn, canned it. Everything was, my father grew. Okay. And that's what we ate. Now, chicken, yard chicken, that's all we eat. I don't eat that today, but eggplant. It look almost like egg when you fry it.
Right.
Oh man, he used to love that. But we had to eat what they eat.
Right.
And on Friday, whatever got left over, my mother used to call it potluck. Put everything together. You might find this, and you might find that. But then my mother had a strict rule. Daddy eat first. All of we used to get to the table and eat together, but Daddy got first. And since I was the baby boy, I always got the butt of the chicken.
During my early age, my grandmama used to can vegetables. And they used to can okra. We used to have to cut up all these okras and snap these beans and then there, get the mason jar in there, or wash it, and then they have to put the cangers in there and let it boil, lance and boil, and cook in a big old wash tub over open fire. Then they'll put it up, and then they'll share with the neighbors, talk about, oh, I got these jar of this and jar pea and all this. They give, they share all this stuff. Even with meat and stuff, they share. They kill a hog, they share. I love cooking for my grandmama. My first dinner I had fixed, I had to stay home from school one day. And she told me, she said, come on, I can show you how to cook. I cook beef stew. And like, you know, when the short rib, okay. And she showed me that, and I've been cooking ever since. I like to cook everybody. I've been a cafeteria worker for 28 years, and I love that job.
Well, at home, I remember my dad, he had a little garden out back, and we would plant potatoes and whatnot. And so that after the season was over, we had to do the potato bed, where we put the potato in the straw, the pine straw, and then cover it up. And how at times, you know, when it's time to go out and to bring some in for the house, you had to dig a little hole and pull those in. Remember my grandfather, he had the smokehouse out back of his house that they would cure the meats, and that's where everything was kept. And you can just walk by and smell the aroma of the various meats that they had. And I can't really remember Grandma making any preserve, but I'm pretty sure she did, because we did have some around the tables with that biscuit then for breakfast and sometimes even dinner.
Rice was with every meal.
Okay.
With every meal. It's funny, I still burn rice today. I do. When they have the bag ones where you could just pop it in a microwave, but it's not the same.
No.
So, and the reason why, because I know that I burn it, because I don't stay there and watch it. And, it's funny, I would watch my grandma growing up. She would have like this little stool by the stove, She'd sit there and stir the rice. She'd have the TV in the corner and she'd be watching her stories. She never left the food. She never really measured anything either. Everything was love. My grandma on my dad's side, she would make cakes for the community. So I'd watch her cook. And especially with the cake, she'd let me eat the batter and stuff like that, but I would always help her. So the patience, love, skill that she gave towards, the attention that she gave towards the food, I got that really, really early on to wherein I applied that to my work. I always watched her when she was so, when someone would come to her and say, "Oh, Gladys, that pie you made was just phenomenal," or, "Oh, the cake that you made was just," and she would make jelly layered cakes and all that stuff. But when she got the compliments, she lit up. And it just made me think the time, the attention, the patience, the detail, it was all there. And I experienced that, and I watched her. So while she was, you know, back and forth watching stories, you know, she loved Young and the Rest of the Show. She'd say, "Tell me what Victor's doing." Okay, Victor's doing this, Grandma. And she's like, "Tell your brother to run through the house. You're gonna make my cakes fall over." Just things like that. Yeah. So the attention to detail and the patience is something that I applied to my work from having that experience. But food was pivotal to me.
You know, it's interesting in that a lot of things that we as Gullah people ate were so packed, filled with flavor, you know, and the sweets were really, really sweet. And my grandmother used to tell him, because y'all, you know, y'all the first generation of us growing up getting a whole piece of cake. You understand what I'm saying? Or getting a whole glass of juice or whatever. Everybody had to cut those things real small, because you had like everybody to feed, not only just people in your family, but whoever was coming, everybody had to get a piece. So everybody's used to getting these little, so it had to be packed full of flavor and packed full of everything, because you only got two and you better chew it slow. So, you know, all this, grandmama want a piece of cake, a whole piece of cake? You want a whole piece of cake? Who you think you are? I told my daughter, I said it was me, my brother, and my cousin. We grew up like sisters. We'd be down here every summer. I was in junior high school, I think, before I had a whole can of soda. You had to split that bad boy three ways. Yeah, but a whole lot of ice, man. Jiggle that ice and do what you gotta do. But you had to split that soda three ways. So, you know, so things were small and packed, and then you had a lot of rice and a lot of potatoes or whatever, a lot of gravy, but everything else was small, strips of meat, small pieces of cake or whatever, you know.
There was another relative who lived in the same community as we did, and her name was Miss Freeze, and that was her basket name, I guess. She was born on the first day of a hard freeze, because her name was Hester Washington, and I really didn't know her real name until later in life. It may have been at her for her obituary, because she was Miss Freeze, and then she was known as Miss Freeze. And although rice was not grown much, not as a cash crop on St. Helena Island, I remember her in the field beyond her house, they grew rice, and she would thresh rice, and they had a mortar and pestle. My family did not. There were a neighbor, because in the front of our house there was a low-lying field for a summer or two. He grew rice in the field in our front yard.
Every day, at least, you know, once a day we had rice, or twice a day. And some people here would eat rice three times a day. Yeah. But then at that time, I didn't know how important rice was to the African community, or that we had brought it here. The only thing my father would say where we live on the west side, you know, it was very, when it rained, it's just a lot of water. And he would say, oh, you know, all of this is just a rice field. You know, rice was such a process of cultivating and whatever. I think a lot of times our ancestors blocked it out. A lot of people don't know that, but they did. They never talked about it. Now, this time of the year, they would be gathering up that rice, chopping it. And then when, at that time, South Carolina was just full of diamondback rattles in those fields and rats. And when they would pick up rice, you know, you could be bitten by the snake and the rat at the same time. Then if you go early in the morning and here, you know, this is time of the year that you have a haze down there. You don't know, you can't see that well. You know, and sometimes people tell the story about rice when you go to the plantation, about the crystal ball and how many, who got married into who and what they got. And, you know, say, oh, well, you know, the African-American brought rice here. But they don't know the condition. And then in March, you were out there throwing up rice, I mean, the silk, putting it on the bank. And the thing about it, you had no shoes on your feet. And we died from pneumonia. When I talk about some of the older people, when I really got into my culture and they began to say certain things, but actually they blocked it out. That's a long time of blocking out.
The older people had wisdom. We go under the house. They didn't want you to go under the house. They didn't want you to go in the bush. Now, boys could go in the bush, girls couldn't. Boys could go under the house, but girls couldn't. It took me years to find out why. Because they tell us that if we go under the house, there's a black snake. And the black snake would wrap you up and whoop you if it give you one whoop. That means you got one day to live. If you go in the bush and they whoop you, that's how many times they whoop you, you're gonna die. So boys and girls never played together unless it's baseball or basketball. That's it. No woods, no tree climbing, yeah, and all of this. But otherwise than that, no. Years and years when I grew up, then I found out why. I didn't know it was a different, but I thought we all were rough and tough. And so one day I was going in the woods and the black snake jump up and hit my leg. Man, I was running a mile an hour. I run home, I said, Mama, a black snake would be like a die. And she took the broomstick and said, no, there's an antidote. No, you don't, she didn't say antidote, I can't remember. And she hit me. And so that's cancel out that. I said, whew, yes. I sure didn't want to die.
Well, there were things that my mom did, like, for example, she would say, well, if your hand itches, the palm of your hand itches, that means you're getting money soon. If your right eye jumps or something, that means someone's talking about you. There was one time when I was, I think it was 12 or something like that, and I was playing at my grandma's house, and I stepped on a nail, and I didn't go to the doctor for it, but my grandma's on the one line, my mom's holding the phone, and my grandma's telling her what to do, so she took a tweezer, and she did peroxide, and some other stuff, and she said, go get some spider webs. And packs of spider webs in the hole. And I'm like, what?
They call it Life Everlasting Tea. Okay. It's a tea that they blend, you know, and they would go out and find the root, you know, the weed, put it together, put honey, you know, lemon. And after you drink that, whatever cold you got, it's gone. Flu, whatever, it's gone. And you can see what they will give it to us, and you know, they'll put heavy clothes on us, and I'm like, Mom, I'm hot. Mom, just be careful. She said, be all right. You'll be all right in the morning. You wake up wet with sweat, but you don't have the cold.
Folks used to talk about something called a plant eye. And I was never able to figure that out. They said that this thing was supposed to change into different forms, but never experienced it. But as a child, it did cause some fright. Yeah. As you're walking home at night and you're kind of thinking about those things that people have placed in your head.
There is the folk belief of the hag. The hag is believed to be an elder person. It could be a man, but almost always it's presumed to be a woman who has the ability to shed his or her skin, become invisible, and then throughout the night, it goes and torments people. It torments them by sitting on their chest, riding them. Supposedly, they pull air out of their nostrils. It's also been said that the hag has the ability to pull the blood out, and a hag sometimes would sell a victim's blood for profit. So if you know of a community member who didn't have a job or had just a piece of job, it always seemed to have ready cash, it's probably a hag. And there were ways to rid oneself of a hag. Babies were protected at night by putting matchsticks in the baby's hair, because matchsticks had sulfur on it, and hags supposedly could not stand sulfur. Some people curse at a hag. Some people would place an open Bible or place a newspaper somewhere in their room, because a hag would have to read the entire written content from back to front, and had to read the whole document in its entirety before morning. If that did not happen, the hag would not be able to get back into its skin and then would die. During my childhood, my bedroom was covered with not wallpaper, but newspaper. And I don't know if that was so much to rid the room of hags, or that's what was available. But that was what my room was decorated as, newspaper.
I remember as a young child, a male relative who was about to pass away, lying on a cot of some kind in the middle of the floor, and us being very, very scared. It was like I can't even remember exactly how old we were. But he was lying on a cot in the middle of the floor, and he called us all over to him, and he told us to open our mouths, and he just breathed into our mouths. And all of us, all the little kids, did that. And shortly after that, a couple of days after that, he passed away. So someone told me later on that was that person's way of giving each one of us something from him. So not literally his last breath, but pretty doggone close. And in his last breath, he was giving us whatever. And that those things would be revealed to us as we got older, what it is that he was directly passing on to us.
Well, I had this grand uncle. And I says, Uncle Jake, I says, how come black folks couldn't get out of slavery, free themselves out of slavery? I said, why couldn't they use roots? So Uncle Jake says, sit down here, gal. Let me tell you how that thing worked. He said, if root been for walk, he says, black folks would have never been in slavery, and we'd have had all the white man money. He said, you see Sookie? I said, yes, sir. He said, Sookie been going with Mary Jane's husband for years. He says, I watched Mary Jane one day, took a bag of flour, went to Sookie's house, put it all on the step, down the walkway. So when Sookie came out, she thought that Miss Mary Jane had put something on her. The sookie fell down. Say, he ain't broke up one leg, he broke up two. But he said, let me tell you, someone could put something in your drink. Someone could pick something that could either kill you or make you very sick or paralyze you or what. So I always listened to my Uncle Jake. He couldn't read nor write. He was in World War I. But this man was highly intelligent. And he would also tell us that black people need to start business and hire their own. And he says, as long as we stay in America, that black people will need white people and white people would need black people. So true. All of us need each other.
Well, over time, it seems that we are now accepting it more, because there was a time where we, when someone would call us a Geechee or something like that, we would be offended or take offense to what is being said. But now I believe that we are now trying to delve more into our culture to find out who we are, because for a while we did not want to be associated with it. But now I think that we are more, it's more acceptable now, and we are trying to go a little bit further back and deeper into that culture of Gullah Geechee.
You know, I don't think it is bad. It's just bad as it was when my grandmother and them came up. You know, I mean, you know, discrimination is just inherent in, I guess, in any culture. And I don't think it just has everything to do with black or white. I think it has a lot more to do with status, the rich versus the poor. And they always saw that as a poor man's language. But actually, that language basically got a lot of our ancestors free, run to the north, because they, you know, it was a code language, you know, that got them away from, you know, the hardship, you know, what they would call hell in the south.
Now, mind you, we could not speak any Gullah in that classroom. And this is the thing that was, those African-American teachers were no different from a white person teaching out on the reservation. Get rid of that bad talking or whatever. And then I always says, well, thank God that we had two recesses. We had a big recess and a little recess. So we would speak Gullah to each other once we got outside.
I certainly see a lot less shame around the language. Because that was a big deal when I was growing up. I mean, we were forbidden from using any, I mean, you would get slapped upside your head if you didn't, you know, if you slipped, you know what I mean? And it was,
go ahead. So is this at school?
No, this was at home. Yeah, you better not let nobody tell your mother that you know what I mean?
Okay.
No, so this was at home. And I was blessed to have a grandmother, both my grandmothers and both my grandfathers growing up. But I was also blessed to have two great-grandmothers. My great-grandmother, my grandfather's mother, that's all she spoke was Gullah. She wasn't able to fluently go back and forth, but she didn't want us to speak. She didn't even want to hear us speak it because she felt that it would hold you back, yeah.
When my wife and I would do our CLM presentation for school groups, it was a Bluffton Elementary School where a third grader, an African American, in the cafeteria, she turned around on that little swivel chair, cafeteria chair, she covered her ears, she closed her eyes throughout the whole thing. Those pictures of historical pictures showing aspects of slavery or even post-slavery or people dressed a certain way, and we were singing spirituals and folk songs and talking about local history, and it was just too much for her. She was ashamed, and a change within the past 20 years or so, I would say there are a vast number of people who have begun connecting or reconnecting with our heritage and realizing that some of the beliefs in the stories, though humorous, that there are connections with our heritage, and that our heritage didn't begin during slavery, that and really a sense of pride.
I think people understand Gullah and they know where it comes from, and I think that they can appreciate it, but the passion, there's a difference. We can celebrate it and we can rejoice it and we can understand it and we can appreciate it, but to be passionate about something, you have to be consistent. That consistency, you have to understand the skills, you have to understand the reasoning, you have to understand the psychology behind it all. Once you understand, then you can apply the consistency with the passion. And then Gullah celebrations won't just be a day of celebration. It will be more of a daily, what? A way of life. A way of life. And it's not that we have to speak like the Gullah culture, but it's the foundations and the traditional methods that they applied and use with their life that we can apply to our own.
I think I was in elementary school. What really made an impact is when we went out to Hawk Car. And then we went to the Rice Museum. They had the little, you know, drawings of the fields and stuff like that. And that kind of like, kind of drew me in to like, man, wanted to dig deeper. Right now, that's why I see myself now going back into, you know, history and trying to bring back, you know, that, you know, culture, like in the 60s and the 70s, you know, kind of get our kids today to look at where we came from as an, you know, African Americans, and where we came from, you know, 400 years ago to up to now, and if, you know, just get these kids who don't know where, you know, where we came from as a people, so, you know, they can, it can be still fresh in their mind. They could teach their kids, you know, I can use some of my artwork to inspire them, you know, just inspire them, you know, and just, that's the thing that I just want to inspire.
I didn't get interested in doll making. I think doll making kind of got interested in me, and it really started off as my grief work after my brother passed away. And you know, now that I'm sitting here thinking about it, I had a conversation with my brother who was, I don't know if I could say, but he was a flame, okay? He was just a flaming man. And he knows I cannot stand Barbie. I can't stand Barbie, okay? I'm sorry.
That's fine.
You know, but it's just too unrealistic, you know what I mean? So he bought my daughter a Barbie for Christmas the year before he passed away. And I was so mad with him. I was like, now, you know, I don't know why you bought this girl a doggone Barbie, because you know I can't stand Barbie. And he looked at me, and you know, he was such the drama queen. He said, I am a dying man. And if I want to give my niece a Barbie, that is exactly what I'll do. Then he named the Barbie Boomshika the Barbie. So it was just ridiculous. I was so glad when she lost Boomshika. I was just so glad when that happened. So after he passed away, I thought I was prepared for his death because he was ill. He had contracted HIV at 18. He died when he was 28. He came home for 3 years and we really worked to give him good quality of life, my mother and I, while he was here. But we knew that he was very, very sick when he got here. So I thought that I was prepared for his death. And we were, in terms of all the physical things you could do, and but emotionally, it threw me for a loop. And at that time when I was struggling with depression, these dolls just kind of appeared to me, and I didn't know what they were. I was on antidepressants. I figured that it was them things making me loopy or something, you know what I'm saying? But I really do think that my brother left them for me to do. And after I had been making them for a while, only thing I know in the beginning is that every time I made one, it made me feel better. And I needed to feel better, that's it. And I needed to get off all that stuff and clear my brain, because I couldn't see color clearly, I couldn't taste anything. And I needed to get off of that stuff. Every time I finished one, it just made me feel, it just lifted my spirits. Afterwards, I started to realize that they represent all of the women in this community that have done awesome things for me, you know, raising me and instilling all these things in me, and that I needed to pay respect or homage to them for all the things that they had, you know, and are continuing to do. So I believe that he just, you know, like in his fashion, he just gave me something so dramatic, just because he was just such a dramatic man, you know. He couldn't just send me some simple sign, you know. He had to do it grand, right, you know. So that's how I started to get to make the dolls, you know. I use a bottle-based doll, and I'm not a traditionalist by any means, but my mother used to tell the stories, and my grandmother used to tell the story of the younger girls, and sometimes boys too, having to, you know, young people used to take care of younger siblings. So you could be 9, 8 years old, but still have to be responsible for getting up and getting that 3-year-old ready and dressed and ready to go with whoever was going to keep them or whatever, getting yourself ready for school. You'd sometimes have to make sure that younger child ate. And the biggest thing for my mom was hair. So she had to make sure that hair was done. My grandmother had to make sure that hair was done. So they would sit and practice with using those little Coca-Cola bottles. They would stick the long grasses in the Coca-Cola bottles and hold them between their legs, and then they would, that's how they learned to braid. And so that's why I use the bottle-based dolls. So they don't look anything like that, but that's why I use it. That's where that comes from. Yeah. And then I use wire-based dolls simply because I needed more. I was diagnosed with MS a while ago, a long time ago, and I needed something to help me with more movement. And so the wire-based dolls kind of helped me with that. So I could move arms and legs and torsos and that kind of stuff. And it was just very therapeutic for me to be able to move, make it and then move it. You know what I mean? You know, I use very dark skin on the dolls. Most times I do have, you know, varieties of shades. Most of the time I work with very dark skin, just to celebrate that. It's still very difficult to find dark dolls, and growing up it was something that was very difficult to find. And so I want for people to have an image that represents women who look like, you know, who look like me. I think that the colors that I'm addicted to, the colors that I use in the dolls, not so much that people were so colorful, but I think that their personalities and their characters or characteristics were very colorful. And I'm always mindful of the fact that the women, many of the women that I'm celebrating, are women that didn't have an opportunity to allow people to see them as they truly were. And so they were not allowed to let their feathers spread out and for people to see the wonderful colors of their lives. You were a maid, you were a mammy, you were a laborer, you were whatever it is other people said you were. And so, you know, to me, this gives me an opportunity to allow those women to dance and smile and be happy, and to let people know that you are I was more than just what you said I was, because you needed me to do a certain thing, you know? But I think that not so much the what the dolls look like is Gullah, but what they stand for and who I'm celebrating and the reason why I'm celebrating come out of them or out of the Gullah traditions.
We went to Charleston, and they had the Moja dancers there then. Okay, so I started working with the Moja dancers, say for about five years. We do shows. We open up for, hey man, Burning Spear, Lucky Dubé, Sister Cal, you know, Brigadier Jerry, you know, some Grammy winning,
right.
You know, brothers that were on tour. And when they would come through, okay, we open up for them. There's a phoniness about it, okay? And it got, you know, when you get to a point, well, how much are you getting paid? Well, what are you getting? What's that? You know, then you have the groupies, man. You know, like after the show, then here, all the females. It's like, oh, come on, man, I got a wife, you know? And, you know, my thing is, if you're going to represent something, man, represent it, man, you know? Don't just let your dog collar come out. I guess I was more cultural, okay? So what I did is I said, well, okay, I have my son, and my son would always, he started with me with a tambourine, a drum. I'd subcontract another drummer from Oyutunji Village, okay? And my son would play. I'd teach him like a, you know, boop, 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 boop. Just, you know, a timekeeper, right. Clave, or a little shakeray. Then my wife, she knew how to, you know, play a bell, okay? And she could dance. So that's kind of how we started. Okay, so, and my son was in Pampas, okay? And next son, you know, as he advanced, it's okay, well, you know the percussion. Now you're gonna play the bottom. Which is basic, doom, da doom, 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 da doom, 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 da doom, doom, and it will do all the things on top of that. But you maintain the bottom. Then my next son, that was Hassan, the next son, Saud, we put him on the clave, you know, do, 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 so he can understand time and how things fit in together, okay? So once we, and then my third son, Pianchi, this guy just was a percussionist. Okay, I had bought a balafone. I said, I'm gonna work with it. He wants the balafone. I got a steel pan. He wants the steel pan. Okay, so it's okay, I'll give it up. This is my son, you know, so you got it. Okay, that was Pianchi, the third one. Then the fourth one, Jabari, he's a drummer. Okay, so we said, well, look, my son Hassan said he wanted to be a top player, which is probably the one that gets all the attention, okay? Because we set up everything beneath him. He's one on top that just does his thing, okay? And that's what he, you know, wanted to be at that point. And I'm like, I want to play the top, right? But I said, no, if that's what he wants to do, that's what, you know, he'll let him go that way. I like to, you know, say, encourage them. I like to be real with them. I like to let them understand pitfalls. Don't get too big, man. Don't believe, you know, like say the crowd or believe it's like groupies. Don't really believe that. No perfection in your heart, man, from the work you put in it.
After being in the military, stationed in Germany, my last tour in Germany, and they had a wood shop there. And I wanted to build a cabinet for our bedroom. And so I started going to the shop and talking with the guy that ran the shop. And he began to show me some different things. And so I purchased some wood and started on the cabinet, but then was not able to finish because I was deployed. But then after I came back home and we moved, I finished the cabinet up in Maryland. And then from there started doing small things. And as I came home after I retired from the Army, got home and was unemployed and bought me some equipment. And from there, I just started doing small things, buying woodworking magazines and taking the patterns and making things from the patterns that were in the booklet. And then from there, I just got, I would say, inspiration. Every now and then, I would get something in my mind, and not having the ability to really draw it out from my mind, I would go on the computer and begin to look at clip arts or different things, and then downloading them and turning them into patterns, pretty much. And from there, would make these items and give them away to family members or friends as gifts. And after I continued to do this, people began to see my work and desire to have. So I went on, and from there got my business license. Most proud of was a gift that I gave to my sole surviving uncle on my father's side. I found this tree online, and so I took the tree. And then I continued searching and found also a pattern of a root. And so I combined the two to make a tree and its root, and then began trying to figure out how could I make it even better. So I implanted my grandfather and grandmother's name in the root of the tree and made it into a pattern, blew it up about 30%, and then place it on a piece of wood and begin to cut that out. And once we were through with the tree, I had all of my aunts and uncles and my father and took their names and all of their children and put each name on a board that I placed the tree on. We completed that and framed it and everything and presented it to my uncle, and that was, I think, one of the prize that I created myself. And from that, now all of my uncle's children would like for me to do one for them, and my sister and a few other family members also.
My grand aunt inspired me by helping me do these baskets.
She learned.
My grandmama taught me how to make baskets. We used to just make the flat part.
Okay.
But my first aunt, one of my aunt, I used to always stay with her, and she taught me how to turn the basket up and make styles. And my other aunt, she did the same thing, and helped me to make different styles and shapes. And that gave me the inspiration to keep on sewing. Sometime when the other one be running around and playing or whatever, I'm always being the one sitting on the porch and making baskets. And to this day, I think I'm the only one that actually sew basket and keep the basket going for my family. I join in with some ladies that does different types of basket, and they put me under their wing, and they had me going all different places and sitting in the mattress with sweetgrass basket. Some people didn't like it because they talk about you shouldn't do this and you shouldn't. I said, well, when God give you a talent, you supposed to share that talent because it's history. You're supposed to pass the word on.
One time I had a ranger, which was a white guy, and he's the guy that helped me to be timber foreman, which at that time, you know, was a separation between black and white. And I had an idea that I wanted to give him something special. And one day I was walking through the swamp, and I saw that cypress knee. And I said, wow. And I went there and got this chainsaw and cut it, took it home and let it dry and made a lamp out of it. And that thing was so pretty. And then somebody else saw it in his office. And then after that, this one won it and that one won it. My brother had already was doing the walking stick. So I said, well, you know, I'm gonna try. That's this. So I tried a cypress knee. And being a black person, I figured, you know, because my father didn't carve the things that I'm carving.
Right.
My brother didn't carve the things that I'm carving now. So I took it to a higher level, in which I figure if my grand or my sons do it, they would take it to another level. But I'm the only some person that still do natural sticks. And a lot of people get confused when I say natural stick. These are natural stick from South Carolina.
Okay.
These are oak, dogwood, hickory, cherry, maple, some pine, some cypress. This is most of the wood that my father used was dogwood because it already had a natural handle. And then each handle, each sticks are different. So that's what I love about my stuff. When somebody stop out here, they're not going, like you go get a metal stick and every time you walk, go click, 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 click. Look, suddenly somebody following you.
Yes. Yes.
And a lot of people want to get rid of that metal stick and rather have walk with a stick that don't make them look old. Plus, when they see like an eagle head on the top of something, the people forgot that they got a problem. They're more fascinated with the stick than the man or the woman. I customize sticks that I got probably 100 sticks out there and there's no two alike. And I've been in this business now for almost 28 years and I haven't found two stick yet alike. All of my sticks are handmade and nature made. So when you buy one of my sticks, you're getting a real deal.
I came home in 80. The children came home, and the twins wanted, they met some of their cousins because we were always in a predominantly white community. And they said, could they go? It was a hard decision. We said, okay. So we brought them, and they finished Georgetown High. And then I started a business on Front Street, and I had was selling lace and other African American things and whatnot. And I had opened up 10 days before Hugo. Wipe me out. But I started because I've always collected, and I was in when I was in Pennsylvania for years. I sold black collectible and did doll shows.
Okay.
You know, so I had been doing it for a very very long time. Then when I came home and I started over there, and I had all of these artifacts and whatnot. We had a, because we had the room had a lot of artifacts. And one of the girls came in, she said, this is not a shop. Her name was Laura Lewis. She said, this is a museum. So that's where we started the museum.
Okay.
And we were over there for 15 years. I enjoyed it, but I think I'm having so much fun in Georgetown and just seeing Georgetown coming back up again. This used to be the predominantly black section. And this building here used to be called the Hub Building out there because it's a large building. At the time, we didn't have a gym and they would use it for basketball and whatnot, and the school dance and a lot of things would be here. And on Saturday, all of the cars would come from the rural area and they would park over there in Rainy Park, and this street would be black. Front Street would be black. When I was a kid, if you had to go downtown, you didn't want to come down until about 5 o'clock just to get whatever you needed because it was so packed with all black people from the rural area of Georgetown. Because you know, for a very long time, Georgetown County was 95% black. The city is about 59 to 60% black. A lot of people don't realize, but it is.
I guess when I look back over my body of work, I can say that it greatly influenced it. From the stories that I would do as a newspaper reporter at the Beaufort Gazette, and following up with those stories after I left the Gazette, and including those stories and others in my first book, Reminiscences of Sea Island Heritage. After it was published, my wife and I scripted the contents of that book into a performance piece that we called Sea Island Montage. We had just scripted a small portion of this performance piece, and we were called by the director of the Penn Center to come to perform for a group of museum curators who were meeting at Penn Center on the next day. Would we? And we said, well, sure. And we took our written script, we stood up, we read, we sang, and the 50 museum curators gave us a standing ovation. And we said, oh, we must do something with this. I began writing publicity. They would call, and then we, for several years, that's what we toured. Here at Brook Green, and I narrated as well as scripted the Lowcountry Trail audio tour, which the Lowcountry Trail has four sculptures unlike any other sculptures at Brook Green Gardens. And they're cut with laser beams. They're made of stainless steel. And they are of four characters who helped to shape what we know today as Gullah Geechee culture. They are the plantation owner, the overseer, the enslaved African male, and the enslaved African female. And I was tasked with coming up with an interpretive program that would show the relationship within those characters. So I scripted a fictionalized story about the perspectives of each of those characters about life and death. And it takes place on a plantation day at Brook Green Plantation about some 200 years ago. I got some comments and they said that it did not show all the cruelty that was experienced by those during that time. And after, you know, considering what was said, I said, well, that isn't what I wanted to leave people with. I want to leave with the strengths of our people during those times. And I think that's what it accomplishes. My books, my recordings, in a large part deal with just passing on a sense of empowerment about Gullah Geechee culture.
History is something that, like I said, I explored. I was watching ETV the other day, and it was a segment on African Americans, Many Rivers to Cross. And that, along with in school, learning about African Americans, slaves, Gullah culture, things that they had to, I would say, change to wherein it wasn't always sad, it wasn't always depressing. Things that they had to manipulate to make the best of. Those were just things that I all looked at and thought and wondered. I'm a very curious person, and I always try to find the meaning behind things. It was eighth grade, and I met Jonathan Green. And for me, that was the first artist that I saw that really painted the Gullah culture and really loved it and was passionate about it. So after going to our class, went to see him in Charleston, and after seeing his work, it just made me even more curious about it. There's a lot of history in those fields. That's what my grandfather would say. There's a lot of emotion. There's a lot of achievements. There's a lot of changing turning points that the U.S. was built on. And We can't forget that. So for me, in my own way, in my own unique way, I try to, and when I started out, I tried to show a glimpse of that history. But in the present, the rice culture, I know firsthand, the patience and the love and the care that you had to make sure that it's right, I experienced that. The Gullah culture is something that it stands for identity. I think that, you know, during those times, they needed a sense of purpose and identity, and they wanted to feel connected. The rice feels, and the rice as a food is, I think, a connection. And it's historical. And sometimes when I'm driving, even coming from Charlotte, or at the time when I was living in Florida, seeing the rice fields and coming over the bridge into Georgetown, it's a lot of wonder. It's a lot of wonder. And it captivates you. And I think there isn't another place on earth that I think that captures this piece of history.